I will be glad and rejoice in it.
Take in this service, those who are online viewing this service, may you please bless us like only you can.
shout glory.
Glory.
Somebody shout glory.
Glory.
I have to think of what Jesus has done for you one more time. Can somebody shout glory?
Thank you.
thank you, church, that sometimes, you know, on this journey, we need Jesus all the time. Because he is our strength.
Yes, he is.
Hallelujah. He is our help. Yes. And as we journey, as the first song says, if you trust in the Lord, though your body may feel tired, but yet Jesus is our strength, we won't get no ways tired.
That's right.
And while we are on this journey, you pray to him, ask him, lead me, Lord.
Amen.
Help me, Lord. Yes, we're going to have some difficulties.
Yes,
we're going to have some circumstances. But how many of you know that if your hand is in Jesus' hand, he won't let you go. He won't leave you alone. Somebody tell Jesus thank you.
Amen.
Can somebody tell Jesus thank you? Or can somebody ask Jesus right now? Can you ask him, just leave me?
never have left me alone. It's one thing, the same songs of such assurance when it comes to God's presence. Know truly within that he has not left us alone.
Yes.
But we can dismount from our podium and our pulpit and our choir loft and we can go through the week and we sometimes ask ourselves, Lord, where are you at? Then we have to draw in our mind and think about what we have just affirmed to everyone, that he'll never leave us alone. That's why it's hard. And it takes a lot of prayer, not only from the individual, but from those that's connected to pray, because the devil is busy and the mind is battleground. Amen? Truly, we thank God for the choir for singing so beautifully in our hearing, and we thank for. Thank God for everyone that has played a part or been a part of the service up to now. Now this time we ask to pray with me and for me. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for this appointed time, this assignment on today. Realizing, Lord, that you could have chosen someone else to go. But Lord, here I am. Speak through me and use me. There's only you can.
Yes.
Crucified flesh, and it's always say tame this tongue that no man can tame. That the words that flow from my lips may be words of edification, words of healing, words that gonna kill and destroy the onslaught of the adversary. So now, Lord, we ask you to continue to mold and shape this service as you already have, Lord, healing and deliverance may be the end results of this day. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be accepted in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my deliverer. Amen. I want to share with you same words that have been read in your hearing coming from the book of Psalm and Isaiah. Psalm 46 and 10. Isaiah 54 and 17. Psalm 46 and 10 4. Coming from the 17th verse. First part it says, no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. This morning I want to speak or preach to you as a spiritual guide with this thought in our mind. Seeing your deliverance in spite of what's in front of you. Seeing your deliverance in spite of what's in front of you. My brothers and sisters, we as a people have the tendency to look at present occurrence in others' lives, and we speak death before it even happens to someone. In other words, to help you understand what I'm saying, you just seen a bad car wreck. Oh, they are not going to make it. That wreck's too bad. There's no way they could come out of that. Then we visit the hospital, and whether it be someone of the family or a church member, we go in and we pray a prayer asking God to heal that individual or basically work a miracle in that individual's life, and no sooner than we step outside of the door and we get home or get to the car and someone asks, how are they doing? And we say, they don't look too good. I don't think they're going to make it. You even speak that to yourself sometimes. When you're feeling down in your body, you say that, I don't feel like I'm going to be able to make it today. The scripture says that death and life is in the tongue. And we speak over our own destiny. Have you ever been there? Have you ever said something that now that you're thinking about it now that you never should have said concerning someone else's condition? Well, my brothers and sisters, as we look at Psalm 46 and 10, when it says, be still and know that I am God. If you will allow me to make this disclaimer, because some may interpret Psalm 46 and 10 differently. This scripture has been referred to exegetically because we often take from it declare something that's not intended in the message itself. In other words, Christians with good intentions may use this as a consolation in time of worryation or in times of frustration to make people feel the sense of hope, as if God is saying, relax, don't worry about it, I got this. But what God is actually doing, he's addressing Israel, and he's not just telling them to be still and rest. If this is during the time of war, which it mostly was, God is commanding them to stop fighting momentarily and open your eyes and see who I really am. War and destruction is inevitable. But so is God's final victory. In other words, God had the last say-so. At that time, all will stand quietly before the Almighty God, and that's why we should take time out of our day to be still and exalt God and think of his goodness. I said that because I will be referring to the same scripture read to your hearing with the same intentions of giving you hope. Hopefully you will agree with me when I say that, saints of God, we have a problem letting go of yesterday's problem as we journey into a new day of hope. Although this is a day that the Lord has made, we reach back into the back lobe of our mind and we grab stuff and we bring it and we place it into our destiny. Well, there's no reason why Apostle Paul declared that in 1 Corinthians 13 and 12 that we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face, now I know in part. But then shall I know even as also I have known. We know there is a sustaining hope, yet there's a dark side of life that will even come forth and it's hard for us to get. In other words, it's hard for us to let go and let God. Damn right about it. The hopelessness of disorder will crowd the mind of Christians when it seems like the odds are against them being healed, seemingly seem like a report that's not true. You can't find a job, more bills than money, ministry seemingly at a standstill, and the list go on and on in our mind. Have you ever found yourself there?
Yes, sir.
Have you ever found yourself questioning the destiny that God has showed you before you got saved? Well, my brothers and sisters, the reason for this seemingly absent blessing of assurance is that sometimes we get caught up in our good days, brother preacher, and not remembering that bad days are going to come. We forget who is in charge of the days of our life, and there is somewhere in our life that we can't seem to understand that no matter what happens, God's anointing and gifts with all its fullness don't exempt us from persecution. It don't exempt us from ups and downs or any kind of despair that the world has to offer. We dwell on our circumstances of life instead of looking to Jesus, who is the joy in a time of trouble. We dwell more on what we're going through rather than what we have come out of. We dwell more on what we're going through rather than what God is getting ready to bring us into. We dwell more on the valley that we're in than the revelation that we find in the valley on our way out. We dwell more on what we are suffering than what God is delivering us from. Now, no matter the size of the mountain in front of you, Brother Winton, you need to stand still and let God show you your deliverance. We are in the fourth month of the year, and some of you have been through a whole lot of stuff and still dealing with a whole lot of stuff. But the prophet Isaiah has declared that no weapon formed against you. Now, I don't care what it looked like. I don't care what the devil throw at you. I don't care what it smelled like. I don't care which way it's coming from. It doesn't matter. I don't care who has been in it. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. And anybody, anything that raise up their voice against you and accuse you, you shall speak it down and bring it down. No matter what you've been through, now what you're going through now. The second part of Psalm 35 tells us that we may endure for a night. But joy, it comes in the morning.
Yes.
But listen here. To be able to see your joy before the morning comes, you got to be able to believe that your deliverance is there waiting. You got to see joy before the morning comes. You got to experience joy while you're going through your trials and tribulations. Yes. Because that's how you wrestle it out of the adversary's hand.
Yes.
I refuse to let the devil go with me in my morning and have a part of the joy that I'm receiving.
Yes.
But see, you got to understand this. The devil shouldn't go with you. Now, he's going to put up a facade to make you think that he's willing to wrestle with you all night long till that joy comes. But that's a lie. And the reason why, the devil is scared of joy. The devil can't handle joy. Joy uproots the devil. Joy makes the devil tremble. So you can make the devil tremble while you're going through. Why wait till the morning? Your morning can be all night long. Isn't it good to know that you won't have to wake up in the chaos that you're going through always? Isn't it good to know that a change will come after a while? Isn't it good to know that trouble don't last always? The only thing that lasts always is the word of God. The word of God will outlast anything. My brothers and sisters, God is building any situation that you're going to lay down with tonight. Now, you can get rid of it. Brother Preacher, have you ever laid down with a headache at night and got up the next morning the headache would come? Ain't that a testimony? A testimony is a testimony. See, we look around, we look for big testimonies, huh? We got to think about the small testimonies too, amen? Because the small testimony equips you for something large.
Yes. I like that, preacher. Hallelujah.
Life has many toils that will sometimes cause even the holiest person to question themselves in faith. In which they labor in.
Yeah.
The reason why God is bigger than any problem or situation that comes our way is because He's a God of abundance. Somebody say abundance.
Abundance.
You know that abundance in the overflow that David was talking about when he said, my cup runneth over.
Come on now.
You know the abundance. When Paul said, my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory.
Yes.
Oh, you know the abundance that came from two fish and five loaves of bread.
Yes.
You know the abundance that came from the barrel of water when they were celebrating and all of a sudden it turned into wine.
Yes.
You know the abundance when the dead man sat up in his coffin when he was in a funeral procession on his way to the graveyard. You remember when Peter said, I don't have no draw, but there was abundant when he reached in the fish's mouth and drew money out of the fish's mouth instead of going to the bank. You know that abundant when the enemy thought he had your back against the wall. But you fell back there against the wall. And God had gave you a door in that wall. You know the abundance when you realize that could nobody do you like Jesus. Well, my brother and sister, God has a unique way, an unusual way of exposing himself to us. Very first, when it seems like it's impossible. In other words, we look for bad things to happen. When it seems like the odds are fixed against us, we have a problem. Realizing that God, that the Lord is our shepherd, and He'll supply anything we'll ever need. When you're going through, He always be the first one on the scene and the last one to leave. I don't care what it looks like. It might look like it's the end, but God, my God, right there when the fire starts. All that God has done for us. Yeah. That
I can say there's a bright side somewhere. I can
inside, working on the outside, bringing forth a change in my life because I could see my deliverance.
Yes. Yes. My God, my God.
The Bible tells us that I have not seen, ear heard, and even have entered the heart of men the thing that God has promised them that love. I believe that the lady that had the issue of blood was here today. I believe she would tell you that I could see my deliverance before it even arrived. I believe that the blind bondman was here today. He would tell you, I may have been blind, but I could see my deliverance. I believe that Peter's mother-in-law was here. She may say, I may be laying on my bed of affliction. I may, my body may have left the bed. I may have been changed, but in the midst of all that was going on outside of me, all the praying, I could see my deliverance. I believe that if somebody here today or somebody viewing today can testify that no matter what you're feeling right now, no matter what it looks like, no matter what the doctor said, no matter what the devil's trying to do, trying to steal your hope, I believe that somebody can say that I can see my deliverance.
Yes.
So whatever your deliverance that you see, hold on to it.
Yes.
Don't let it go. Because that change is coming.
Yes.
It's right here, and all you got to do is just let God have his way. We love you on today.
Yes.
Pray that God gave you something that, not me, but God has given you something that's going to help you hold on just a little while longer. Because seeing your deliverance in spite of whatever's in front of you is very important. We can move everything out the way that's physical. But things that's spiritual, we can't move it out the way. We'd rather not get flesh and blood, but darkness, principality and darkness, high places. So don't let the devil paint a facade to make you walk away. We're going to ask you to come to your feet. There may be someone on the side of my voice who don't know Christ as your personal Savior. Stand in hand of discipleship right now. Knowing that if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he was crucified, he died, they buried him, and on the third day he got up out of the grave, so thou shalt be saved. Now, you got to believe that he got up. You can't believe that somebody dug him up. But you got to believe that he was dead and he rose up on his own with all power in his hand. Thou shalt be saved. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this word that went forth. We thank you, Lord, for ministering to me as a minister to your people. Now, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you basically, Lord, allow your people, Lord, to be steadfast and unmovable, always abiding in your word, realizing that they just stand still and watch your splendors, Lord. Watch your word. Lord, realizing, Lord, that although things may look hard, but they still see their deliverance on the other side of everything they're going through. Father, we thank you, we pray you, we glorify you. I pray in this name, we pray, amen. Right now, my brothers and sisters, we're getting ready to move into our communion session. We ask that our deacons and mothers prepare that we may go into communion. All those desires to remain with us, please do so, because after the